So you see, if you don't make that separation to understand that you are holy, that you are separate from the things that are happening around you, when things happen, you will always come out to deal with them. You will always respond to them. And it is in that response that we find ourselves acting in the flesh. And we rise above the fear of death, the fear of men that plays out in the flesh. You know, what men will do to us, what men will not do for us. We fear shame, we fear reproach, you know, losing face in the sight of men. I think one of the worst things that the prince of this world has done is to get us to be so invested and attached to ourselves so that we are almost unable to bear it, to overcome, to let it go when things happen to us. You know, when something is done against us, or we have a bad experience, or we are in lack, or even the positives, like when something good happens, or we make an achievement, or we attain something that is not average. You know, just the way that we tend to be attached to ourselves causes us causes it to be completely impossible for us to distinguish who we really are and the things that we have. You know, it's as though there is no distinction between what we own and who we really are. The best example to illustrate this is, for example, when we are offended, you know, when somebody does something against us, and we see how difficult, like when you experience betrayal or, you know, hurt, like deep emotional hurt, or a terrible, terrible traumatizing experience, and then you look at how difficult it usually is for us to let go of these bad things, you know, to separate ourselves from them. Like, we are not able to see that those things are not who we are, you know, that we are already intact somewhere deep inside, somewhere separate, completely separated from the things that have happened to us. And I think it is a diabolical attempt by the enemy to this kind, or this way of linking us to the things that happen to us or the things around us, so that he can get to us, because we understand that the true us, which is the spirit, is inaccessible to the devil. And so what does he do? He is trying to get us out of that core, that deep, where we are hidden in Christ, where we are hidden in God, and to get us to engage him now on the stage of the material, you know, the physical, you know. And how he does that is by making us feel like we are not any different from, we are one and the same with the things that happen to us or the things that surround us. And when we are attached to things and our environment like that, it becomes extremely difficult for us to let things go, you know, to forgive, to forget, to walk away, you know, to just let things go, especially when they are big issues, especially when they are hurtful. We're not able to see that this is just something that has happened on the side, where somebody has been nasty or something bad has happened, and that it doesn't necessarily have to reach us in our refuge where we usually reside, like in that deep, still, quiet place where we reside in the spirit, that we don't always have to be reached by even the deep hurts that we experience, that this deep-seated person that is the real person in us doesn't have to be affected. They don't have to come out even you know, to see what has happened, we should be able to see that the things that we experience in the earth usually only hurt our body, that they don't really get to our spirit unless we allow them, unless we are in this deception where we think we are actually equal or banded with our environment and the things that we experience, the things that happen to us, the things that other people do to us, the things that they call us. We are not able to see that we are not those things, that those things that we experience are only happening to our body and not our spirit. But because this real us is tied up to our body, it makes it almost impossible for us to survive our experiences, especially the bad experiences on the earth, to come out of them with our hearts intact, with our mind sober and sane. We are affected by default because we are connected. There is that attachment that our spirit has to our body that should not be there. There should be a separation where we know that we are not our body. And there is the unwillingness, therefore, because of this huge attachment, where we feel that now our respect, our dignity, our identity, our worth and value is attached to what happens to our body, that if it happens to our body, it's happening to us. Because of that, we are extremely unwilling to go through pain, to go through suffering, to go through shame or embarrassment, because when it happens, it feels like it's happening to us. You know, it is we who have been rejected. When we are rejected in the natural, we feel that the true us is the one that has been rejected, whereas that is not the case. You can see that by how invested we become when people are talking about us, especially when they are saying things that are not true about us, and how that can bother us, because we have equated this image, external image that we carry around, to who we really are, you know. And so it's so important for us to keep up appearances and for people to view us in a certain way, whereas that should not be our concern. It shouldn't take away our focus. It shouldn't even receive any of our efforts and resources. It shouldn't take up any of our time, because we know that we are who we are, and as long as we are honest and genuine in the things that we do, in the things that we say, then it doesn't matter how we are perceived, because now we leave the perception to the person who is doing the perceiving, and how they perceive you is entirely up to them, and it's their responsibility. And even that whole judgment that they come up with is still on their court. It doesn't have to reach you. You know, when you have been wronged, or somebody has created an entirely painful, unpleasant experience in your own physical space, you have to see it as their own thing. You know, it is them that is having the experience and not you. And it is them who are having the experience of creating this unpleasantness. And we have to have the courage to allow to lose control of our body. You know, our environment, for the most part, is out of our control. When you wake up in the morning, you are not able to forecast or tell or decide what is going to happen around you. The only way you have complete power and jurisdiction is in your inner man. And that is the real one, the real person, the real you, the most powerful you, the most authentic you, and that is the only you that matters, that really matters at the end of the day. So we have to have the courage to face whatever will happen to our body that we don't have control over. And the only way that we are able to survive without losing the peace in our hearts, the joy and peace and rest that we have in the mind and in the heart, is by making this distinction, to understand that what happens to your physical body is not really happening to you, the true you, and you are willing to feel that pain. You see, now there is that willingness we have to have to suffer in the body, in the flesh, in order to keep our spirit intact. When we are not willing to suffer in the flesh, we will be resisting evil. And yet the Bible, the Word of God, says that you should not find yourself resisting an evil man or resisting evil. And when it says resisting evil, it means you don't find yourself striving with it. You know, you're trying to reply in kind when somebody comes at you the wrong way, or you're trying to avenge yourself, you're trying to prevent this experience from hurting you, things like that. When you direct your energy and your focus in that direction, that is when you begin to lose your peace, your inner peace. You begin to lose that inner man, and you're completely distracted. And at that point, now the thing that you could never have reached you, the thing that could never have affected you, the thing that is far beneath you, you know, now can consume you. It can it can destroy you, because you have come out of that inner sanctuary, and now you're striving with things in the flesh. The Word of God says that our battle is not against flesh and blood. We do not wrestle in the flesh, in the body. We wrestle with thoughts, we wrestle with ideas, we wrestle with faulty knowledge and understanding, and things that exalt themselves above the knowledge of God, in the mind, in the realm of the spirit. And that is where it matters. If you cast it down there, then it has no power over you in the body. And the trick of the enemy is always to get us to come out of that inner sanctuary and to bring the battle to the stage of the natural and the physical, where he now can consume us. He can actually get his hands on us, whereas the way that God created us, as dwelling in this inner hidden deep sanctuary, the enemy would not be able to access us, to do anything to us, to hurt us in any way. And the only thing that he can hurt is our body. And if that is the case, then we have to be willing to receive these sufferings, so that we can obey and please our Lord. So you see, if you don't make that separation, to understand that you are holy, that you are separate from the things that are happening around you, when things happen, you will always come out to deal with them. You will always respond to them. And it is in that response that we find ourselves acting in the flesh. And we know that the flesh is the root of sin. The flesh is the stage where sin plays out. When you are not in the flesh, you cannot fulfill the desires of the flesh, and therefore you cannot sin. And so when you're not able to make that distinction, you will always respond to the things that are happening to you in the body. And in that way, you're not able to live and remain in the spirit, which is your position of power. That is when you are most powerful, when you remain in the spirit, and not when you come out to defend yourself, to fight for your rights, you know, to protest, and that kind of thing. So in a way, it is as though we abandon our body to be like loot. You see, like the way something precious or valuable can be left on the roadside for just anybody to take or do whatever they want with, our body is like that. And we don't have to do it consciously or deliberately or intentionally. That is the way our bodies are. That is how we die unexpectedly, because we are not able to control our environment to that extent. And when we are willing to lay down our life our body as a living sacrifice, to let whatever will happen to us in the flesh, in the body, to happen, and we know that the one who avenges us is God, so we leave it to God. It's not that it doesn't matter what happens to us in the body, because God loves the whole of us, and He cares about the whole of us. He cares about our dignity. When our honor is, He defends He fights for our honor in the eyes of men when we belong to Him. You know, in as much as we are already honorable in His eyes, in truth, He still cares about how people treat us. He still cares about the things that happen to us in the body. And when we understand that, we just have to accept the truth that we will suffer in our body, that we don't necessarily have to suffer again in our spirit, and that God is the one who avenges us in the sufferings and the things that we lose in the body. He's the one who restores. He's the one who restores. So we never really have to come out of our shell, of our refuge and our resting place, to defend ourselves or to care for ourselves, to protect ourselves, you know, to look out for ourselves. We understand that He's there to do that for us. And when He allows bad things to happen, then He does so for a reason. And we would do well to just agree with Him and to partner with Him, you know, to be willing to suffer, because He also suffered in the flesh for us. For us to be willing to suffer, so that the work that He would have done in us would happen, and we are made perfect in the end. He actually brings suffering our way, and allows us to go through painful things, shameful things. Because He cares more about the spirit man than He cares for the body. You know, He understands that if your spirit is destroyed, even your body is of no use to you. And that is where it hurts the most, when you don't have any peace, when you don't have any joy, you know, when your sense of identity, belonging and worth, value are destroyed, and there is nothing in the physical that can build that up for you, that can buy that for you. You know, you cannot buy peace or joy in the shops. So He will always allow certain things to happen to us, and when it happens, we are wise when we see that if it happened, then it is God who allowed it. And even if it wasn't God who allowed it, then He will cause all things to work together for our good, so that we can get out completely out of the flesh. We can completely get out of the flesh, and we rise above the fear of death, the fear of men that plays out in the flesh. You know, what men will do to us, what men will not do for us. We fear shame, we fear reproach. You know, losing face in the sight of men, we are able to come out of that fear, to overcome it, and to come out of the flesh where the enemy can get a hold of us. And in that state, we are able to say that, like Jesus Christ said, that the prince of this world has nothing on us. You know, He is not able to access us, He is not able to reach us. Because no matter how much He stimulates us in the physical, you know, changes things around in our environment, you know, causes all manner of things to happen. He's like a showman trying to pull strings to cause you to react, to cause you to act, to cause you to do something. And eventually, his intention is to cause you to change into somebody else, so that you have people who have gone through certain really bad experiences and they were not able to survive, they were not able to overcome, that it changed them. You know, they become rapists, they become perverts, they become abusive people, they become, you know, they develop addictions and things like that. They're completely not able to survive. And you see, that is the intention of the enemy, to get us out to react and to attach ourselves to the things that happen around us. And we fall into all manner of sin. We fall into all manner of wickedness, and there is so much pain. One thing about being in the flesh is that you can never be free from pain. And yet in the Bible, there is a place where when God finally comes for his beloved after the tribulation and they have overcome, he wants to take them to a place where there is no crying, there is no pain, there is no shame, there is no lack, there is no hunger, you know. And this is the only way how, you know, how he does that is by getting us out of the flesh, out of the body. That is where all the pain is. You know, when you live in your ego or in your soul, where you care so much about how people talk about you, what they say about you, what they do to you, you're so aware and you care so much about what happens to you, you know, it leaves you vulnerable to a great deal of pain. You're so vulnerable, and that explains all the defensiveness that takes place now in when we are in this state where we are dwelling in our ego or in our soul. You know, we have all manner of defenses because there is a great awareness of what we are vulnerable to, like what we are exposed to, the kind of pain and loss and you know, shame that we can experience while we are in this realm. But when we make the transfer, when we shift, when we move out of that realm and into the realm of the spirit, then all that ceases immediately. You know, somebody can do something so terrible to you, and yet it doesn't cause you to even lose sleep at night. You know, it doesn't move you, because you're not dwelling in that realm where the enemy would have you dwell. You know, the worst things can happen to you, but your spirit is able to remain intact. And that is where God comes to deliver us to, when he takes us on this journey of salvation, this walk of faith, when he calls us out of our motherland, you know, when he's calling us out of the world, when he's calling us out of the flesh, the deeds of the flesh, he's trying to deliver us to this heaven and this Zion, this Jerusalem, the city of peace, where the enemy can never reach us, in as much as we are in the world, but we are not of it. And so the things that the world suffer, the things that the world is afraid of, you know, what they call conspiracy, you don't call conspiracy, because you're not in the world, you're completely separated. We also have expectations where we constantly have an idea or an expectation of how we want things to turn out, like how we want things to play out, how we want them to be, how we want the people we love or care about to act towards us, what we want them to do. And these expectations set us up for now disappointment, and they anchor us even deeper yet in the flesh, in the body, in the physical, you know, in that external result, so that when things don't turn out the way we want them to turn out, we are devastated, we are taken aback. it takes a moment for us to recover. The only expectation we should have is based on what the Word of God says, or what He has told us directly. That is something that we can expect, and even when it fails, to persist in positively expecting it. But when we expect things based on our emotions, based on our own desires of what we want to see, how we want things to happen, because of our preferences, because of our fears, because of our pride, then that is a risk, and it just now puts us out there vulnerable to now these disappointments, pain and hurt. And this is absolute and complete total freedom. This is what freedom looks like, when you don't have to react or to feel the things that are happening around you as a spirit man. When you're not like a puppet, a string puppet to the enemy, when he pulls the string, a string in your finances, then you jerk and you respond a certain way that he has predetermined, and he's able to predict you, and he's able to know how you're going to respond when certain things happen around you. In this form of existence, where we're dwelling in our body, in our flesh, we are not able to please God. We are not able to worship God as we should, because there is always these constant distractions that are going to happen. We dwell in a highly unstable and volatile reality when we are dwelling in the flesh or in the physical. But the spirit is stable. The spirit is already determined that there is only peace, there is only joy, there is only good, there is only light, there is only goodness there. You know, we cannot have any surprises there. So we cannot be able to transit into this new reality, the reality of the spirit, the reality of heaven, when we are unwilling to suffer in our flesh. The person who will make it to the other side, where God intends for us to dwell next to him, to be seated next to him in heaven, far above every principality and power and the rulers of this world, the only person who is able to get there is the one who is willing to have whatever will happen to their body to happen, even to the point of death. The Word of God says, be faithful even to the point of death. You know, where your body has been completely beaten, you have been insulted, you have been rejected, you have been falsely accused. You know, our Lord and his followers and his saints, we see all of them going through that, and they were faithful. They walked this walk of faith to the point of death. You know, they suffered in their flesh to the point of death. But some of us will never come to that point. You know, it's small things we are not willing to suffer. You know, like suffer shame or losing face before men. That fear of men, especially in our age where we have social media and people really want to be popular. You want to be in good graces with everyone. You want to be loved. You want to be liked. And our levels of fear are so high, so that the enemy will never even have to get us to a place where we have to lose our life, you know, to bleed. All we are being threatened by or being threatened with is the loss of this dignity, and the loss of even losing friends, you know, losing even maybe a job, losing that popularity if you have it. those are the things that we are being threatened with, and most of us are not willing, we're not able to forego that, in order to experience that death to our flesh. Be willing to allow the enemy to do whatever he wills to your body, because when you don't have that willingness, that surrender, then you have the fear, that fear of death and the fear of men. And with fear then comes bondage. You're a slave to every scenario that is going to happen around you, to people who come your way. You become a slave to your environment. You become a slave to your body. But when you're willing to go through anything, come what may, then you lose that fear. And when you lose that fear, you are free to obey God, to follow Him wherever He will lead you, to accept whatever He gives into your hands as something that you have to suffer or experience. You have that freedom of worship that we talk about when God called out the Israelites out of Egypt when they were slaves. And He said that He wanted them to leave Egypt so that they would worship Him. You have that freedom of worship because now, when things are happening to us and we're responding to them with fear and anxiety or pride and things like that, that is a form of worship. It is a form of worship to those things. But when they are happening and we are not moved, you know, our focus is not taken away from the Lord. We still remain with Him, able to worship Him like ordinary days, able to praise Him and to honor Him and to have good feelings towards Him, even when bad things are happening. Now that is worship to God. But the enemy wants to steal the worship of God with the things that he brings around, good or bad. He can bring even success and achievement to cause you to now redirect your focus away from God and to those things where now you're so overly impressed with yourself or with the person who has achieved that thing, that now that becomes a form of worship, idol worship, that is the main form of worship of the world. Revelation 7:13. Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they, and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve Him day and night in His temple. And He who sits on the throne will shelter them with His presence. Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes."